It's my life. It's now or never. Alistair and June, and good afternoon, everyone. When it comes to voluntary euthanasia, I'm a bit like that ubiquitous punter in the art gallery who drawls,
"I don't know much about art, but I know what I like."
So while I had a brief moment of panic when I was asked to speak to you today, realising that you probably all know far more about voluntary euthanasia than I did think, well, I don't know much about voluntary euthanasia, but I do know what I'd like. I'd like to be able to die with dignity. If I'm lucky, that will mean a natural, mostly painless death, hopefully in advanced old age, in my sleep, cuddled up to someone who looks uncannily like George Clooney. But if that's not to be my fate, and terminal disease, unmitigated pain, catastrophic physical injury or dementia are to be my destiny, I'd like to be able to gain medical assistance to end my life in a quiet, dignified way at the time of my choosing. I realise, of course, that voluntary euthanasia is highly contentious and raises a number of legal and ethical issues. And of course, I don't want my freedom to lead to the exploitation of the poor, the lonely, the elderly, or the vulnerable. So I do think it's important to have access to enough reliable information to make an informed choice about whether claiming my right to choose inhabits others' rights to live. More importantly, I'd like policymakers to base their decision about whether to legalise voluntary euthanasia on accurate and reliable information. But as I'm sure you're all painfully aware, this is not what's happening in the debate over voluntary euthanasia. On the one hand, we have scientists, doctors, nurses, academics, and concerned citizens like you presenting data from a wealth of evidence-based, peer-reviewed research. That data clearly shows that in countries and jurisdictions where voluntary euthanasia is legal, it is safe and well managed. Predictions that legalising euthanasia will negatively affect the quality and availability of palliative care, that it poses a disproportionate risk to certain vulnerable groups, and that widespread abuse is inevitable, have consistently been disproven. But still, the debate drags on, with the waters muddied by various groups whose arsenals include rumour, innuendo, misrepresentation, and unattributed anecdotes. Of course we need balanced debate. Of course we need informed choice. But as I've been arguing recently on a completely different topic, you can't make an informed choice when one side of the debating team is just making shit up. As people who know a great deal more about voluntary euthanasia than I, it's probably not going to come as a great shock to you when I suggest that most of the misinformation about this subject comes from religious institutions and their fundamentalist supporters. But today I'm going to take this argument further. I'm going to suggest that you aren't the only victims of religiously motivated propaganda. I'm going to suggest looking at the issue of voluntary euthanasia more broadly. And I'm going to ask you to consider forming alliances with groups which are fighting on other fronts, but which share the same broad goals as you. And what are those goals? Well, it seems to me you aren't just fighting for the legalisation of voluntary euthanasia. In broader terms, you're fighting for a secular government, for a clear separation between religion and state. Because if we had a truly secular government, one which based its policy decisions on reason and credible evidence, voluntary euthanasia would be legalised tomorrow. Not only that, a whole lot of other arguments about discrimination and human rights and individual autonomy would also be resolved. And I could spend my days at the beach instead of ranting on the internet. So as you see, I have a real vested interest in this. By the time I've finished today, I hope you might gain a slightly different perspective on the campaign to legalise voluntary euthanasia. And that is, in common with a whole lot of other groups, which you may never have considered as potential allies, you're fighting for a government that won't bow to large, powerful, and wealthy religious pressure groups, which seek to impose their views on those who don't share them. I guess in a way, I'm calling for a secular revolution. All for one and one for all. Unity, equality and fraternity and all that. When people share common cause, you can achieve far more by uniting to form an army than by fighting individual pitched battles. So I'd like to begin today by telling you a horror story about voluntary euthanasia. It's quite a common one and you may have heard it, so if so, I hope you'll bear with me. It concerns a 26-year-old ballerina from the Netherlands. Believing she can never dance again because of the arthritis in her toes, she visits her doctor and explains that she can't imagine a life without dancing. Indeed, if she can't dance, she doesn't want to live. She asks her doctor to help her end her life, and reluctantly he agrees. One doesn't enjoy such things, says the doctor, but it was her choice. The way the story's told, it appears the ballerina received medical assistance to die on the basis of just one consultation. The doctor apparently suffered no penalty for helping this depressed and only minimally incapacitated young woman to die, and he feels free to share this story with appropriate regret with other medicos, perhaps over coffee and port at some medical conference. This story is what drew me into the euthanasia debate, and which started me thinking we might all be involved in the same war against the encroachment of religion into our secular government and its institutions. A slightly wonky version of the ballerina story was told on the ABC panel show Q&A, question and answer. There's a section of the show where they ask for audience input. And on this particular night, an audience member decided to seize his 15 minutes of fame to launch into a long, apparently well-rehearsed diatribe against euthanasia. A diatribe which included the ballerina story. After the show, I got a Facebook message from my friend Dr. David Leaf. I know David through my secular activism, but he's also on the board of Dying with Dignity New South Wales. David was furious. He was convinced this fellow, who represented himself as an ordinary citizen, was a plant from the anti-euthanasia lobby. And he'd just been given a huge free kick to spread a large amount of very damaging information on national television. What are we going to do about this, Chris? Said David. It was very late at night by this time, and my first thought was, we? What the hell do I know about voluntary euthanasia? But I soon realised that David was right. We had to do something. So with David's assistance as technical consultant, I spent a couple of weeks researching the propaganda from the show And we wrote an article debunking everything this fellow said on Q&A, including the ballerina story. Appropriately, the article was published on ABC's Religion and Ethics website. Now, while I was doing this research, David suggested that in his experience, if you follow horror stories about voluntary euthanasia back to their source, you're almost always going to find a religious motivation lurking in the bushes. I had this in mind as I searched for the source of the ballerina story. The ballerina story, of course, isn't true. It couldn't possibly be true. Any doctor who acted in the way described in this anecdote would be serving time for murder, regardless of whether voluntary euthanasia was legalised or not. I checked extensively for any record of this incident in newspapers and court reports, and I could find nothing. David's contacts in Dying with Dignity checked with their counterparts in the Netherlands. They confirmed it could never have happened, as described. They had never heard of such an incident, and if the story was true, the doctor certainly wouldn't have been broadcasting it because the end result would be a very long stint in jail. In short, it's an unsubstantiated anecdote, an urban legend. Let's call a spade a bloody shovel. It's a lie designed to frighten people into opposing voluntary euthanasia. But where did this urban myth come from? It took me 2 weeks to track down the ballerina story back to its source. And when I found it, I was in for a surprise. At face value, there didn't seem to be a religious connection. In fact, I found the first person to disseminate this story publicly appeared to be a very well-respected, well-credentialed American surgeon. So much for David's theory. As far as I can tell, the ballerina story was first aired publicly by Dr. Robin Bernhoft during an interview for the 1995 anti-euthanasia video, Euthanasia, False Light. My first thought was that maybe Dr. Bernhoft wasn't a real doctor, but then I found his rather impressive biography. A physician and research scientist, Dr. Bernhoft has his undergraduate degree in biology with honours from Harvard and a medical degree from Washington University Medical School. He has published over 20 scientific papers. I admit I was a bit taken aback. This fellow seemed very legitimate. But I decided to keep digging. And this is what I found.
It ain't a song for the broken hearted. Smile.